Moving on to science on TB latency, research and innovation in TB prevention, implications for people living with HIV. This session will be co-chaired by Dr. Eduardo Gotuso, who is the principal professor of the Department of Medicine and director of the Alexander von Humboldt Institute of Tropical Medicine and Infectious Diseases at the Caetano Heredia University in Lima. He is also the head of the Department of Transmissible Diseases at the Caetano Heredia Hospital.
Good morning. Buenos dias. For me, it's a pleasure to be here. And thank you to Beatriz and Alfredo to invite me to be in this important meeting. And it's an honor for me to share with Karin Turner from South Africa. And I would like to review very quickly why, in our opinion, this is one of the key topics to discuss tuberculosis. Everybody knows it's curable diseases, however, in the last century, 100 million people die. And still right now in the 21st century, still the people is dying from tuberculosis. But the other important part is preventable diseases. And you see this morning four different views about how important it is. And this latent infection, you know, is an asymptomatic infection, and we have not a good criteria only to measure about that. And we understand when you acquire the infection, in the next 2 years, you have between 5 to 8% to develop tuberculosis disease. But this risk is very important when you have HIV. Every year, you have 10% of risk to develop tuberculosis. That is, in 5 years, you have no diagnosis, you have 50% the risk to have tuberculosis disease. And again, this topic is important because that is the places that the moment you can reduce the risk. And this is very important when you see in the community and then you see in the HIV patient, you can reduce this part important if you can make in the proper way. And right now we know what is the proper way. The other part we know, we have a different community statement right now. When you asking in Africa and you make a diagnosis from tuberculosis, almost 30 to 60% of the people have HIV. In Latin America, when you make a diagnosis from tuberculosis, 3 to 6% of the people have HIV behind this diagnosis. That is a two different situation. However, when you follow up 5 years and you have no diagnosis, 50% our AIDS patient development tuberculosis. And again, this topic, in my opinion, is very important. We still don't have a good biomarker, and this is very important to review in these days what could be a good biomarker or clinical marker to have a proper diagnosis. One of the key problems, in our opinion, is very important. Everybody concerned from different topics. However, in the last 5 years, there are not PPD production around the world, and nobody cares. For me, it was a surprise because all the time we find in Peru to try to teach to the people how to use the PPD, the main diagnosis, and everybody tried to promote the QuantiFERON or the IGRA. But the IGRA and the PPD is almost similar results in endemic area from tuberculosis. The difference is PPD costs $2 and QuantiFERON costs $60. And that economical difference is very important. And again, we still discuss why nobody cares about the worldwide production from PPD to try to use the prevent measure. Even the doctors don't know what is a PPD positive in one HIV patient. And this, again, one part we need to discuss today. And again, the other important topic is when you have the treatment, there are four treatments in the guidelines from the World Health Organization. And right now, we know a new approach because this plan is between 4 to 6 months. and the follow-up from these 6 months, they have low adherence and low acceptability from the patient. However, this year, the group from Dr. Richard Chason and others presented the option to have only 1 month of treatment in HIV patients to have prevent, and maybe today we can listen more about that. And with this introduction, I'd like to present, we have four experts, and we have four experts who will present different topics. The first one is Dr. Rogelio Hernandez Pando. He is a very well-known chief of pathology in the National Institute for Nutrition here in Mexico, and he published outstanding papers about tuberculosis and HIV. Dr. Pan Hernandez, you have 15 minutes, and I hope we can finish on time.
Well, it's a big pleasure to be here and to participate in this important meeting. I like to present my talk with this frontal page of this classical paper, in which is described for the first time the latent mycobacteria in lung tissue. So Professors Oppie and Aronson established this doing a group, a very big group of autopsies, in which they took some small pieces of lung tissue from people that had died by other causes than TB. And then this tissue was homogenated and administrated to pig. And it was very interesting because many of these samples, more than 30%, without any antecedent of lesion of TB, can produce this disease in the experimental animals. So for this reason, they established that many people have the mycobacterium tuberculosis in latent phase in the lung tissue. This study was in 1927, almost 100 years ago. So we inspired with this and repeat something similar and doing a specific sought to establish the cellular location of these latent organisms and in this case to permit their elimination. So as you know, it is defined that during the primary infection, the mycobacteria is captured by macrophages. They establish a very good elimination of the bacilli, but some of these bacilli survive into the old and fibrotic granulomas. And because of the fibrosis, there is a very hypoxic environment, and this induces the latent phase of the bacteria. So this is the dogma, and it seems that our results are not agreed with this. We use molecular biology techniques to replicate these classic studies by Oppie Aronson. Just get lung tissue from 13 individuals from Ethiopia and 34 from Mexico. All these people had died from causes different than TB. And macroscopically, the lung was completely normal, so we just get the tissue and study by in situ PCR and conventional PCR using the sequential insertion AIS 6110. And looking for this, it was a very interesting study because 35-40% of these tissues were positive with these molecular biology techniques. And interestingly, the lesions that you can see in this picture was not only macrophages, it is specifically these blue dots. As you can see, many macrophages are positive for the DNA of mycobacteria, which suggests latent infection. But not only macrophages, but also pneumocytes type 2, in particular, in this case, epithelial cells from the alveolar walls. Interestingly, also many endothelial cells were also positive. Many fibroblasts also were positive for this IS6110 with in situ PCR. Interestingly, all these tissues were completely normal since the histological point of view. But obviously, the DNA from the mycobacteria is still there, So it suggests that probably latent bacteria will be also in tissues very far away from the classic old granulomas. Then we studied this in extrapulmonary tissues, and in this case also it was a good amount of autopsies, almost 49 autopsies, and all of them, all of these cases, there is any antecedent of TB. These people died because of other things, and interestingly, again, we found extrapulmonary, a lot of tissues, in particular the liver, the spleen, and the kidney, positive. And as you can see here, Kupffer cells in the liver, endothelial cells in the spleen, in the glomeruli, in the kidney tissues, in particular, the parietal cells from the Bowman capsule were positive, and also the tubules, the proximal convoluted tubules, were also positive. Another tissue that is particularly apparently infected by latent TB is the adipose tissue. And actually, we can also replicate this in vitro, infecting adipose cells, a line of adipose cells with mycobacteria. It is very easily for the mycobacteria to infect the adipose tissue. And as you know, not only HIV, but for example, in my country, in Mexico, diabetes is a big problem, and diabetes is a very important risk factor to develop TB. So it is also interesting that we can reproduce all this configuration in an animal model. We use mice, an hybrid F1, with two strains, one resistant, DBA, and the other susceptible mice strain, C57BL, and then infect the mice with a low dose by intratracheal inoculation. And as you can see, for example, after 7 months of infection, we only can found granulomas with big unactivated macrophages. And of course, in these lesions, again, the in situ PCR was positive. But at the same in the tissues, in the human tissues, we also found fibroblasts positive and also a lot of epithelial, bronchial epithelial cells. So it seems again that mycobacteria can live in very different tissues, not only in granulomas, not only in macrophages, but also in adipose tissue and in bronchial epithelium and also in fibroblast and endothelial cells. We, of course, study this with different techniques, in particular with RT-PCR, and we found a very high expression of gamma interferon, very high expression of TNF-alpha, very similar way that in humans. But interestingly, we found a very high expression of antimicrobial peptides, in particular beta-defensin 3 and catalacidin. And we again studied this in the histopathology. And as you can see here, the bronchial epithelial cells is a strong positivity with the beta-defensin 3. And interestingly, when we study this by electron microscopy, we can found in the bronchial epithelium cells some mycobacteria in the cytoplasm, and with immunogold, with using antibodies labeled with colloidal gold, you can see here these black dots is a lot of positivity for beta-defensin 3. And also catalacidin is very positive in macrophages in this animal model, and as you can see here, for example, in this case, a mycobacteria is a lot of labeling with this LL3 tetrate-7 of catalacidin and disruption of the cell wall of the bacteria. So it seems, again, that it's not only TNF, not only interferon gamma, but also antimicrobial peptides are apparently extremely important to participate in the induction of dormancy. And then we started to try a little bit, what about, is it possible to prevent reactivation of in this model of latent infection using these antimicrobial peptides? It's very difficult to use it because they are recombinant, they are expensive. So for this reason, we started to use gene therapy. And in this case, we used adenoviruses. Adenoviruses that in the genetic compound are the gene of the beta defensin 3 and also catelecidine, and of course interferon gamma and TNF, which are extremely important to maintain the latent infection. And you can see here the reactivation. We just take the animals, infect the animals with a low dose, induce latent infection, wait for 7 months, and then in this moment give only one dose of these adenoviruses, recombinant adenoviruses that express different molecules, TNF, interferon gamma, and also beta defensin 3 human and catelecid in human. And after 30 days, we started to administer corticosteroid in the drinking water to induce TB reactivation. And this is very efficient system to reactivate latent infection. And here is the colony-forming units, the amount of bacillary loads. And as you can see here, the control is the empty adenoviruses is very high, the bacteria in the lung. But the animals that receive only one dose of the recombinant adenoviruses, as you can see here, all of them were quite efficient to prevent the reactivation. In particular, the most important was TNF and also catelecidine. And the histopathology is also quite clear. This is a very large areas of pneumonia in the control animals, but in comparison, the animals treated with the different adenoviruses, as you can see, is very small, the inflammatory response. In particular, the TNF is almost a normal lung, in good correlation with this very low amount of bacteria, and also the catelecidine is, in this case, different. There is a very, very big inflammatory response around the blood vessels. And when we study this blood vessel by immunohistochemistry, you can see here very good expression of the catelecidine in these animals that receive these adenoviruses. There is also a very good expression of TNF and gamma interferon, and also very good expression of iNOS. So it seems that it's not only the peptide that has some antibacterial activity, but also the efficiency of this catelecidine to chemoattract lymphocytes, Th1, and also activate macrophages. So all in this conjunction can produce a very good, a very efficient way to prevent the reactivation of experimental latent infection. So the conclusions are this. M. tuberculosis can persist intracellularly in pulmonary and extrapulmonary tissues without histological evidence of TB lesions. And this is apparently a very good strategy of the bacteria to evade the immune system to be eliminated. And interestingly also, MTB is located not only in macrophages, but also in non-professional phagocytic cells, like fibroblasts, endothelial cells, and interestingly, adipose cells. And also, it's possible to use, eventually, gene therapy, only one dose, not necessary is to maintain with different drugs, with different antibiotics, the people that are in risk to develop reactivation of TB, only one dose of these adenoviruses, recombinant adenoviruses, at least in this experimental model, is extremely efficient to prevent reactivation of TB. So this is the persons that participate in this study. Thank you very much for your attention.